This is a DGSNC lecture on branch retinal vein occlusion. Branch retinal vein occlusion is a common cause of retinal vascular disease. The 15-year cumulative incidence of retinal vein occlusion is 2.2% of the population. Of these, 78% were branch retinal vein occlusion, or BRVO. BRVO affects males and females equally in the 60 to 70-year-old age group, and the risk factors for BRVO include hypertension, atherosclerosis, diabetes mellitus, smoking, hyperlipidemia, glaucoma, antiphospholipid antibodies, elevated plasma homocysteine, and low serum folate. Higher HDL lipoprotein, like to moderate alcohol consumption, has been shown to decrease the risk of BRVO. BRVO mostly occurs at arteriovenous crossings. Retinal artery and vein share a common adventitial sheath and in some cases a common medium. The lumen of the vein may be compressed up to 33% at the crossing site. Turbulent blood flow at the crossing site causes focal swelling of the endothelium and deeper vein wall tissue, leading to venous obstruction. Venous obstruction leads to elevation of venous pressure that may overload the collateral drainage capacity and lead to macular edema and ischemia. The symptoms of BRVO include sudden painless loss of vision or a visual field defect. Rarely, patients may experience floaters from vitreous hemorrhage. Signs include wedge-shaped distribution of intraretinal hemorrhage. The location of the venous blockage determines the distribution of the intraretinal hemorrhage. It is less marked if the occlusion is non-ischemic and more extensive if the occlusion is ischemic. Ischemic occlusion is defined as greater than a total of 5 disc diameters of non-perfusion on fluorescein angiography. The most common location for BRVO is in the superior temporal quadrant. Other signs include macular edema, dilated and tortuous veins, as well as cottonwool spots. This is a fundus photograph of a patient with acute branch retinal vein occlusion. Intraretinal hemorrhage can be seen in a wedge-shaped pattern that delineates the area drained by the occluded vein. The occluded vessel is often seen passing underneath a retinal artery, as shown by the arrowhead. Cottonwool spots are sometimes seen, and also note the dilated and tortuous occluded vessel, shown by the arrow, compared to the normal retinal vein in the inferior arcade. Vision-limiting complications of BRVO include macular edema, macular ischemia, and the sequelae of neovascularization, including retinal and iris neovascularization, vitreous hemorrhage, tractional retinal detachment, and neovascular glaucoma. 30-50% of patients with BRVO have a return of vision to 20/40 or better without any therapy. Investigations for BRVO include fluorescein angiography, which delineates the retinal vascular characteristics that may have prognostic significance. These include macular leakage and edema, macular ischemia, as well as large segments of capillary non-perfusion. Findings on fluorescein angiograms include delayed filling of the occluded retinal vein, varying amounts of capillary non-perfusion, blockage from intraretinal hemorrhages, microaneurysms, telangiectic collateral vessels, and dye extravasation from macular edema or retinal neovascularization. This is a fluorescein angiogram of a patient with branch retinal vein occlusion. On the top left, you can see blocked fluorescence from intraretinal hemorrhage. Also note the telangiectic vessels forming collaterals. The hemorrhages obscure underlying areas of capillary non-perfusion and edema. On the right, 6 months later, the hemorrhages have cleared and reveal small patches of non-perfusion as well as macular edema. In this fundus fluorescein angiogram, retinal neovascularization with leakage, as shown by the arrow, can be differentiated from collaterals that are not leaking, shown by the arrowhead. Optical coherence tomography measures macular edema severity and also helps monitor the response to treatment. Findings on OCT include cystoid edema, intraretinal hyperreflectivity from hemorrhage, shadowing from edema and hemorrhage, and occasionally subretinal fluid. In chronic cases, inner segment, outer segment junction disruption from long-standing macular ischemia and edema may also be seen. This is a spectral domain optical coherence tomography of an eye with a BRVO. Cystoid macular edema, intraretinal fluid, and shadowing can be seen. Intraretinal heme appears hyperreflective and produces a shadow on optical coherence tomography, as seen by the arrow. Investigations are indicated in young patients. In the history, ask about a history of oral contraceptive use, diabetes mellitus, or hypertension. Investigate for infectious causes such as Lyme disease, syphilis, and HIV. Perform the following blood investigations: full blood count, PT, PTT, and INR, lipid panel, serum homocysteine, anticardiolipin antibodies, antinuclear antibody with lupus anticoagulant, protein C and S, as well as activated protein C resistance. Older patients more than 60 years old may not require additional workup since the majority of these cases are idiopathic or due to hypertension or arteriosclerosis. In terms of treatment, the branch vein occlusion study for macular edema showed that laser treatment was effective for the treatment of macular edema from due to BRVO. In this study, the eligibility criteria was reduced vision or worse than 20/40 after best refraction. The laser was applied in a grid pattern throughout the leaking area, demonstrated a fluorescein angiogram. A duration of 0.1 second, 100 micron spot size, and a power setting sufficient to produce a medium white burn was used. After 3 years of follow-up, 63% of treated eyes gained 2 or more lines of vision, compared to 36% of untreated eyes. However, if macular ischemia accounted for the vision loss, laser treatment is not recommended. In the BVOS study for neovascularization, large areas more than 5 disc diameters of retinal capillary non-perfusion are at risk for developing neovascularization. Prophylactic scatter laser photocoagulation can lessen subsequent neovascularization. If neovascularization already exists, peripheral scatter laser photocoagulation can lessen subsequent vitreous hemorrhage. Laser should never be placed over extensive intraretinal hemorrhage in the acute phase of branch vein occlusion. This is because the laser energy will be absorbed by the intraretinal hemorrhage rather than at the level of the pigment epithelium. This damages the nerve fiber layer and may enhance the development of preretinal fibrosis. These are fundus photographs showing laser treatment for BRVO. On the left, you can see a grid pattern of laser photocoagulation. And on the right, you can see a pattern of peripheral scatter photocoagulation. Antivascular endothelial growth factor treatment is now the gold standard for management of patients with macular edema secondary to BRVO. In the branch retinal vein occlusion study, sham injection was compared to 0.3 mg ranibizumab and 0.5 mg ranibizumab. In the first 6 months, injections were given monthly. And at 6 months, both the ranibizumab groups have gained 16.6 and 18.3 ETDRS letters, respectively, in the 0.3 mg and 0.5 mg groups, compared with a gain of only 7.3 letters in the control group that received no treatment. The percentage of patients who improved greater than 15 letters was 55.2% and 61.1% in the 0.3 mg and 0.5 mg groups respectively, compared with 28.8% in the control group. Thus, the current recommendation is to treat patients diagnosed with macular edema from BRVO with monthly 0.5 mg ranibizumab. If treatment fails after 3 months, defined as less than 5 letter gain or less than improvement of 50 microns in central subfield thickness, then traditional grid macular laser should be performed. Other anti-vascular endothelial growth factor inhibitors include bevacizumab and aflibercept. Although there are no studies directly comparing the efficacy of bevacizumab with ranibizumab or macular grid laser, the results reported in the BRAVO study are roughly equivalent to those reported in multiple studies with bevacizumab. For aflibercept, 2 multi-centered randomized controlled phase 3 trials, the Copernicus and the Galileo trials, are evaluating its use in patients with macular edema secondary to CRVO. And preliminary results of the Copernicus study show that after 24 weeks, 56% of the treatment group gained more than or equals to 15 ETDRS letters, compared with 12.3% of the sham group. There was an average of 17.3 letters gained in the treatment group, compared with 4 letters lost in the sham group. Steroid treatment is an alternative treatment option for patients with macular edema secondary to BRVO. In the SCORE study, macular grid laser was compared with intravitreal triamcinolone acetonide, and 3-year results from 128 patients suggested that laser group maintained a significantly greater average increase in vision of 12.9 letters compared with the intravitreal triamcinolone acetonide groups, 4.4 letters in the 1 mg group and 8 letters in the 4 mg group respectively. Side effects from IVTA include cataract formation and elevation of intraocular pressure. Thus, IVTA is not recommended as a first-line therapy for macular edema in BRVO, but it can be considered in patients where macular grid laser or other therapies have been ineffective. Vitrectomy with or without schistotomy is a surgical option for the treatment of BRVO. This treatment has produced mixed results due to the risk of intraoperative complications. The availability of less invasive alternatives has limited the use of vitrectomy as a first-line therapy. In terms of follow-up, initially patients should be followed closely every month or every 2 months for the development of macular edema and or neovascularization. Antivascular endothelial growth factor therapy with or without macular laser should be initiated for patients with macular edema without spontaneous improvement. Once macular edema has stabilized or has resolved, the follow-up interval can be extended to 3 to 6 months or even longer in stable chronic cases. In conclusion, current treatments for macular edema include macular grid laser and intravitreal anti-VEGF injections and intraocular corticosteroids. All have side effects. Anti-VEGF therapy typically lasts 4 to 6 weeks, necessitating frequent re-injections, and corticosteroids can induce vision-limiting side effects such as glaucoma and cataract. However, due to its longer duration of action, corticosteroids may play an important role in pseudophakic patients or in patients who do not respond to laser and anti-VEGF agents. Thank you.